I'm going to read you guys the daily scripture. Jeremiah 29, verse 11. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope.
Praise the Lord, saints. What do you say? Good job. All of you. I tell you, we should be very proud of our young people. What do you say? The Lord has given us a beautiful gift in these young people, and I just say thank you so much to Shirley and David, to our club, Thank you for what you're doing with our young people. And we haven't said a lot about our adventurers today, but we have Adventurers that is our club that leads into Pathfinders, but it's a standalone club and just as important as our Pathfinders. But what is Pathfinders? We haven't talked much about that, have we? We see all these cool-looking uniforms and all these sashes and these... Man, I want one of those yellow things to wear when I preach. Just look kind of cool, right? But what is Pathfinders? Well, Pathfinders is a co-ed Seventh-day Adventist youth organization that seeks to teach our young people life skills. That's what all these... Now, help me get it right. They're called honors, right? Did I get it right? Are they honors? Yes, all of their honors. See, I wasn't raised Seventh-day Adventist, so I'm having to learn all these things myself, right? But they have all their honors, the various life skills that they've learned. And for them to get those honors on their sashes, it's not just show up and smile. They actually have to demonstrate some proficiency in whatever they're learning, whatever the particular skill might be that they're endeavoring to gather there. But not only do they learn life skills, we want our young people to know Jesus Christ. What do you say? And so I just want to say thank you. Pathfinders, if you would, all stand up. Let's get a good look at you. Praise the Lord. Now, I know our adventurers. Praise the Lord. Amen. I'm going to have all the Pathfinders sit except the two wearing red braids. So if everybody else would sit. Okay, turn around so they can see your pretty red braid. Now, you saw on the year in review that two TLTs, right? So we're speaking a little bit of code language, but a TLT is a teen leader in training. Okay, so now you know what a TLT is. And so if you see this red braid on their Pathfinder uniform, that means they're supposed to be setting the example and providing Christian leadership to the rest of the Pathfinders, right? And so we're thankful for our TLTs, and I want to ask you to keep them in prayer too, because being a young person, being a teenager, it's hard not to be a teenager sometimes, right? And so they need an extra dose of the Holy Spirit there. All right, Manoah, Megan, you guys can sit down. Miss Miriam, would you stand? I want to recognize our adventure director as well. Go ahead and turn around. Let them see your pretty smile. There we go. Amen. Amen. But you've got some adventurers somewhere, don't you? Where are the adventurers? Adventurers, stand back up. We want to see you. Oh, they're scattered all over the church now. Amen. Well, I want to tell adventurers and Pathfinders, please hear me. I am very thankful for each of you. Thankful for what you've done, what you've accomplished. Did we have fun at the water park? I want to thank Miss Martina. Praise God. Thank you for not putting a picture of me at the water park on the year in review. So I mean, I don't know what we owe her, but let's make sure she gets a double portion of it. Well, yeah. Let that be lost in some archive that is quickly forgotten. Me in a swimsuit is not a mental image you need. But I want to praise God for what's happening with our club, what's happening with both of our clubs. And I know that some churches don't have pathfindering. But I want to share something with you that's significant about Pathfinders before I get into the message this morning. You know, there's an exodus across Christian denominations of our young people leaving the church. And sadly, the Adventist church has not been missed in that as well. We have young people that decide not to stay. It breaks my heart. But out of the young people who stay in our church, it's estimated that 84% of them were in Pathfinders. So tell me that Pathfinders doesn't have a significant impact on teaching our young people what it means to serve Jesus Christ. Because I just won't believe it. That's a pretty big statistic, isn't it? And so Pathfinders, adventurers, are important ministries for our young people. And I want to encourage you, if you've never taken the time to look at Pathfinders, to ask the question, what's it all about? Maybe you want to look at it for next year. Talk to Shirley, talk to David. I know that these guys would be more than happy to tell you about it. And adventurers. Now, Pathfinders is what? Fifth grade through 5 to 12. And then so leading up to that, we have our adventurers. So depending on what the age breakdown is, you'll want to make sure to talk to our club leaders. Would love to see you take part in that. So praise God. Thank you for the invitation to be able to share today. Well, friends, I want to just ask a brief word of prayer, and then I want to talk to you about what it means to see the shepherd's back. See what? See the what? Shepherd's back. Keep that in mind. Let's pray together. Loving Father, Lord, what an awesome privilege it is to see our young people serving you today. Lord, I praise you for that. Thank you for what they've accomplished. And Lord, I pray that our young people would always, always, always want you more than they want anything else in this world. And Lord, today as I have a thought to share, one that I believe you've given me, I ask that you would just please touch my lips, speak through me, Father. Rid me of anything arrogant and selfish. Lord, may you alone shine through. May you alone be glorified. And may everyone that is here, including our pathfinders, our adventurers, be blessed as we consider what it means to look for the shepherd's back. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to ask you something. Have you ever been driving behind someone that you were expecting to lead you to a destination? In other words, they were the ones leading the pack. They had the directions, and all you could do was follow them. How many of you have ever had to follow someone like that? How many, okay, have you have followed somebody who had no idea to have somebody, how it was to have somebody follow them? Right? They're leading the pack, and they see the red light changing from green to yellow, and instead of slowing down and waiting on you, what do they do? And you're thinking, what are they doing? Why didn't they stop? I don't know how to get there. No problem, I'll call them. Hi, you've reached the voicemail of the person that doesn't have enough good sense to slow down when someone's following them. Please leave a message. How helpful is that? Some people don't know how to be leaders. Young people, you need to learn how to be leaders. But the only way you're going to learn how to be a good leader is to follow the right leader. Somebody should have said amen. Don't follow the wrong leader. Don't follow the people who are going to run off and leave you, or worse yet, wait on you and lead you to the wrong place. Follow a leader who's going to get you where you need to go. Jesus is that type of leader. Open your Bibles with me. We're going to look at a few verses today, and we're going to start in the Gospel according to Matthew. Where are we starting? Matthew. So let's go to Matthew, and we're going to look at Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4. Let's turn there quickly. First Gospel of the New Testament, and we're going to look at verse 18. If you're there, give me a hearty amen. If you need more time, say have mercy. All right, somebody needed mercy, we'll give it to them. Matthew chapter 4, in which verse? 18. And Jesus was walking by the Sea of Galilee, and he saw two brothers. Simon called what? Peter, and who was his brother? Andrew. They were casting a net into the sea for what was their job? They were fishermen. Then he said to them, here's the directions to get where you're going. Then he said to them, here's a piece of papyrus. I've written down what you should do. What did he say? Follow me, and I will make you what? Fishers of men. So they formed a small committee, and they took 3 days to deliberate it, and eventually chose to follow Jesus. Is that what it says? I love the word that we find in Scripture. It says they immediately left their nets and followed him. If you're following Jesus, what's the most prominent side of him that you're going to see? The front or the what? The back. If you're not behind Jesus, is it really possible to follow him? No. Who was willing to follow him, at least according to Matthew 4? Their names are in the text. What were their names? Andrew and Simon Peter, right? All right, let's look at another text. Let's continue going. Let's look at Matthew 19. Matthew 19. Are we there? We see in verse 16, Matthew 19:16. Sorry, I didn't give you the rest of it, did I? One came to him and said to him, "Good teacher, what things shall I do that I might have what type of life? Eternal life." And I always love how Jesus would mess with people a little bit. He would always call them out on their trying to smooch up to him. Have you ever noticed that? Notice what he says to them. "Why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God." Was Jesus good also? Yeah. Was he the one that was without sin? Right. And so notice, Jesus is able to read when people come up and they're trying to butter you up. Do you girls ever try to butter someone up when you want something? You do? Well, she was just right out there with it. She didn't hesitate. Listen, that's wrong. Don't do that to people. Right? Come up, "Oh, how are you? It's so wonderful to see you. By the way, can you do all this for me?" Right? Jesus could see through that kind of stuff, so he would call them out on it. But if you want to enter into life, he continues in verse 17, keep the commandments. And he said to him, "Which ones?" And so Jesus goes through, you know, and he lists some of the commandments. Notice what the young man says in verse 20. The young man said to him, "How many of these things?" "All these things I have kept from my youth." And he asked, "What do I still lack?" Jesus said to him, "If you want to be perfect," and notice this, in the Bible, when Jesus talks about perfect, he talks about being complete, having everything that we need for salvation. Girls, do you want to have everything that you need for salvation? No, Jesus wants you to have that. He says to this guy, if you want to be perfect, if you want to be complete, go and sell how much of your stuff? All your goods. Sell what you have and give it to the poor. But where will you have treasure if you do that? You're going to have it in heaven. And then he said, come and do what? What was the last part of the verse? Follow me. Now notice, we see a little different reaction than we did with the two fishermen by the sea. Now think back, Matthew 4, what did we see? How long did they wait to follow Jesus? They didn't wait for a second. What was the word that it said they what? Immediately. It means they didn't wait a second. They didn't think about it. They didn't try to calculate it out. They were like, let's go. They followed Jesus. But what did this guy do? What was his reaction? Notice what it says. But, but when the young man heard that saying, he went away how? Why did he go away sad? Was it because he didn't want to follow Jesus? He came up and said, how do I have eternal life, right? I want to be saved. But why did he go away sad? He went away sorrowful, for he had what type of possessions? So in other words, what did he want more than following Jesus? He wanted all his junk, right? He wanted all of his stuff. And you think about it. I even had somebody ask me one time, well, Pastor, did they even really have cool stuff back then? Right? Right? Because, I mean, we think about our modern age, right? And we've got all kind of neat gadgets and all kind of fancy things available to us, right? And I actually had somebody ask me, well, what did they even really have that was worth holding on to? Well, let me ask you, is the stuff that we have today that great that it's worth holding on to if it means not having Jesus? So even though our stuff might be a little flashier in some ways, it might be, you know, electronic, you might be able to talk to people from, you know, without any wires across airwaves, does that make our stuff any more worth losing your salvation over? No. We should still be willing to give up things and follow Jesus. How do we do that? What does that look like? Let's go to Romans. Romans chapter 12. Where are we headed? Romans chapter 12. Pathfinders, are you keeping up? You following along? Romans chapter 12 and verse 1. Are we there? You guys also saw on the year in review, one of the slides said Pathfinder Bible Experience. Did you see that on the slides? I'm going to tell you, wasn't it the book of Exodus this year? There was a group of our pathfinders who took portions of the book of Exodus and memorized it and came to this Pathfinder Bible experience, and they were asked all kind of questions. And our Pathfinder Club, our group with the Metro Rangers, came in first place in our area and was able to go to the conference competition. Wasn't that right? Yeah, praise the Lord. And they got a good, strong second place there. So way to go, Pathfinders. I'm going to tell you, you hide the Word of God in your heart, it's the best thing you can put in there, knowing the Word of God. Are we at Romans chapter 12 and verse 1? All right, here we go. Notice what Paul says. He says, I beseech you. When was the last time you besought someone? Huh? TLT, I'm waiting on an answer. We don't even know what that means. We don't use that word a whole lot, right? So maybe we should define that word. To beseech someone means that you're strongly urging them, almost to the point of begging them. So when's the last time you begged someone? Yesterday? Okay, so he has besought someone within the last 24 hours. All right, so notice this. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies, what type of sacrifice? What does it say? Living sacrifice. Normally, when you sacrifice something, does it stay alive or does it die? It dies. But check this out. God gives us the opportunity, ladies, to present ourselves to him as a sacrifice, meaning he wants all of us, but guess what he allows us to do? Stay alive. I'm all about being a living sacrifice versus a dead one. How about you? Y'all sign up for that one. Notice what else? Holy. What does holy mean? Pathfinders, I'm asking you. Huh? Sacred. We're on the right track. That's very good. That's on the wrong track. He said with lots of holes, right? That's not what we're talking about. All right, we're talking about something different. What does it mean to be holy? Be righteous. Okay, we're on the right track. What else? Grateful. Yeah. If having sin makes me unrighteous or wicked, being without sin is holiness, right? And so who can make us without sin? Can I do it on my own or do I need someone's help? I need someone's help, don't I? But it needs to be a living sacrifice, holy, meaning it's without sin, meaning I've accepted Jesus, and acceptable, notice the next part of the verse, acceptable to whom? Acceptable to me? To the church? To mom and dad? Acceptable to God. But here's the cool thing. If we're a living and holy sacrifice that's acceptable to God, guess what? It'll also be acceptable to everybody else around you. How awesome is that? Now, notice the last phrase there from verse 1. What's the last phrase say? Which is your what type of service? Reasonable. Would you do me the honors of helping me with something? Okay, hand her the Bible. Come here. Annika, thank you for being my helper. Come here. I have a request to make of you. I would like for you to stand on one foot and wave your arms like this the rest of the service. Go ahead and give it a try. Let's see if you've even got the skills. Okay, you're qualified. Now, if you could just do that the rest of the service, is that a reasonable request? That's not reasonable, is it? So reasonable means it has to what? Has to make sense, right? And it has to be something that happens within the normal course of what you're doing. Now, if I said to you, let's imagine that I was your Pathfinder director, which I'm not, but if I said to you, make sure you show up in your dress uniform, you're a Pathfinder, have your sash on, your scarf, your slide, all of your things, make sure your uniform is in good order, is that a reasonable request? It's a reasonable request because she is a what? She's a Pathfinder. Thank you. You can sit down and please try not to stand on one foot and wave your arms. Makes you look silly. But when Jesus says through his servant Paul, he says that I want you to be a living sacrifice, holy, which means without what?
Sin.
Without what? Sin. Very good. Acceptable to God. And it's what type of service? Unreasonable? It's reasonable. It's reasonable because I have agreed to follow Jesus. Yes or no? So if I've said I want to follow Jesus, giving myself to him as a living sacrifice, a holy sacrifice, one that is acceptable to God, that's the very least that I should do as a Christian. That's the very least that I should do. It's not unreasonable. It's not like Jesus is asking me to stand around on one foot and wave my arms. He's asking me to be his living sacrifice. Now, here's the question. Can I do that if I'm not following the shepherd? Look at verse 2. He expands on it. He unpacks it a little bit more. And he says, do not be conformed. Boy, Paul likes using these big words, doesn't he? I need a pathfinder to tell me what it means to be conformed. Who can help me? Daniel, help me out. Take a stab at it. Okay, so if you're trying to fit in, you're using an example of being fashionable, right, with the right kind of jeans, the cool jeans or whatever. You want to fit in, so you're going to conform or become like, right? So conformity is becoming like something, right? It's you see it and you want to be like it. It's like you want to look in it, and I want the reflection to be what I'm looking at somewhere else. Are you with me so far? So do not be conformed to what? To the who? To the world. And what does the world look like? Is the world, based on what we're seeing here with Paul in Romans chapter 12, is the world presenting itself as a living sacrifice to God? Is the world holy? Is the world without sin? Is the world, the way that it conducts itself as a whole, we're not talking about individuals, but we're talking about as a whole, is it acceptable to God? No. So in other words, don't be like the world. But, notice, here comes a good but this time, right? But, what's the next word, ladies? Be what? Transformed. Now, are we talking about Optimus Prime?
No.
We're not talking about that kind of stuff, right? But, what are we talking about? Being transformed. Transformed from what? Oh, that's good, that's good. Say it a little louder. Being transformed from your old self to what? To a Christ-filled self? Does the Bible teach us that we need to get rid of the old self and become more like Jesus? Oh, mercy, it sure does. Now, be transformed. Go with me to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Where are we headed, Pathfinders? 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And I bet you can guess which verse we're going to be looking at. Verse 1, nope, but it's in chapter 5. Let's look at verse 17. Are we there? Therefore, if anyone is in who? Is in Christ, he is what type of creation? A new creation. And what happened to the old things? They've passed away. What does it mean that it passed away, guys? That I'm carrying it in my pocket. Means it's dead, it's gone, right? You know, I have that ability with plants. In fact, I am convinced that I could kill a silk plant. I just don't have a green thumb. You know, people talk about loving to do gardening. I do my gardening in the produce section at Meijer. I just don't have that ability. But when these things have passed away, should we let them stay passed away? Shouldn't we let them be gone forever? Not try to go dig them up from now and then? But notice this. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, how many things have become new? All things. Close your Bibles, Pathfinders, if you would, and follow along with me now. I have not always followed Jesus. I haven't. I didn't have the blessing of what you have. Boys, are you with me? I want you to get this. This is the most important part, okay? What I want you to get, what I want you to see. I wasn't always with Jesus. I didn't grow up like you guys are having the opportunity to grow up, knowing about Jesus at an early age. And many of you have already taken your stance in baptism. You've already made your decision to follow Jesus. I praise God for that, church. How about you? I want to capture our young people out of the hand of the enemy. So I didn't grow up having the opportunities that you guys have, knowing about what it means to turn your back against the world. And so sometimes, and my kids will testify about this, I get a little upset if I see some worldly things. Megan, is that true? You've seen me do that? I get a little passionate about it. I get a little passionate because here's why I get so passionate about it. I know how hard it is to get the world out of you once the world has its hooks in you. I've had to live that. I've had to struggle with that. I've had to wrestle with that. In fact, it's something that I still have to pray about every day. Lord, help me. Because I was so steeped in the world, I was so much like the world, I was so conformed to the world, that it was only by Jesus' grace that I could be transformed. And so, yes, I get passionate when I see something trying to sneak in and grab hold of my kids. Yes, I get passionate when I want to rescue my kids. And sometimes they get a little tweaked with me. But you know what? I'd rather get my kids a little tweaked at me and take a stand for Jesus than to just throw my hands up and say, oh, world, you can have them. Because I'm going to tell you something. By God's grace, I'm going to fight for my kids. In church, I would say to you, we need to fight for all of our kids and give them every opportunity to know about Jesus. Are you willing to help me?
Sure.
Are you sure?
Okay.
You don't seem real confident. I need confidence. Are you willing to help me? Come on then, help me. You're going to be Jesus.
Okay.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
He was probably a little taller than you, but that's okay. All right. Now, all I want you to do is just slowly walk this way. Now, you're Jesus, and you've called me to do what?
Follow me.
Follow me. Okay, so now you're expecting me to follow you. Now, walk back that way. Follow me. How much am I seeing the shepherd's back? Because what am I doing? I'm running ahead, right? I know better than the shepherd. So instead of following the shepherd, I'm always trying to push behind. Sorry. Be a little kinder to Jesus. But isn't that what we do sometimes? Now, try it again. What did you want me to do, Jesus?
Follow me.
Friends, it's not that hard. I can even do it backwards. Follow Jesus. All right, shepherd, come back this way. It's not that hard. He said, follow me. He didn't say, run past me. He didn't say, you know, you take the lead. You tell me where to go. He said, what was it?
Follow me.
Follow me. Thank you so much. Give Jesus a little hand. So guys, I did that to make a point. And here's the point I want you to go home with. You can't follow Jesus unless you're looking at the shepherd's back. And I want to see Jesus' face one day. How about you? I want to see Jesus' face. I want him leading in my life. But you know what I need to focus on the most? Is seeing the shepherd's back. Because if I'm looking at the shepherd's back, that means that I'm in the right place in the relationship, yes or no? As he's leading, as he's showing the way, if I keep my eyes on the shepherd's back, am I going to end up where I want to end up in eternity with Christ? So let me ask you today, Pathfinders, let me ask you today, church family, how many of you today want to keep your eyes firmly fixed on the shepherd's back? Can I see your hands? Let's pray together. Dear Father, Lord, I thank you so much that Jesus has called us to follow him. And Lord, I don't want to be like the rich young ruler, who that I'm more willing to hang on to my worldly possessions
I want to hang on and conform to the world instead of being like Jesus. Lord, I want to be like Peter, Andrew, James, and John. I want to be like Matthew. Father, I want to be like those other disciples that were willing to immediately follow Jesus. And so, Father, keep us firmly fixed. Keep us firmly fixed on the back of Jesus that we might end up in eternity with him. And Lord, I pray a special prayer of blessing today upon our pathfinders, upon our adventurers, upon their respective families. And Lord, I ask that your blessing would please be with them. Lord, I especially want to pray for our leadership. Be with Shirley and David. Be with Miriam and her staff. Father, I want to lift up Megan and Manoa as TLTs, as leaders in training. Father, fill them each one with your spirit that they might be the godly leaders that you have called them to be. And Lord, I pray this for myself, and I pray it for every other leader in our church, that we would be a living, holy, acceptable, reasonable sacrifice to our God, who is transformed by the blood of Jesus and not conformed to this world. Let our eyes stay fixed on the shepherd's back. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.